Spion Kop, the Hill of Death. In the pre-dawn darkness of January 25th, 1900, two Boer soldiers crawled stealthily up the 1400-foot hill called Spion Kop. Throughout the previous day, they had taken part in attack after attack on the British trenches at the top of the hill. Now the Boer army was in retreat, and the two men were making one last attempt to find the body of a missing comrade. Inching their way from rock to rock, the two Boers crawled closer to the British position, alert for the snick of a rifle bolt or a challenge from the sentry. By the time they were within a few yards of the hilltop, they realised the enemy had gone. Only the dead remained, and here and there the moans of wounded men breaking the silence. So fierce and bitter had been the struggle for Spion Kop, with both sides suffering so much from casualties, thirst and hunger, that each thought they were getting the worst of the battle, and during the darkness silently withdrew, unaware that the enemy had done likewise. The South African, or Boer War, 1899-1902, began on October 12, 1899. By the end of that month, the fast-moving Boers, commanded by the 65-year-old Commandant General Joubert, had bottled up 13,000 British soldiers under ageing General Sir George White in the town of Ladysmith. Led by General Sir Reedvers Buller, a peppery 60-year-old, 30,000 British troops were trying to break through the Boer lines encircling the besieged town. When the Boer General Joubert was injured, he handed over command to 38-year-old Acting Commandant General Louis Botha, an adventurous and daring border farmer. The active, hard-riding Botha soon proved to be a skilled leader in spite of his comparative youth. At the Battle of Colenso on December 15th, Botha repulsed the first major attack on the Boer lines, capturing 10 field guns complete with ammunition and inflicting 1,127 casualties on the British. Soon afterwards, General Buller received reinforcements commanded by General Sir Charles Warren, a 59-year-old veteran recalled from retirement. The British Commander-in-Chief delegated leadership of the next onslaught to Warren. This was to be an attempt to breach the Boer defences on the Tugela Heights, a 1,000-foot ridge, and its dominating feature, the 3-mile-long Spion Kop. Indications were that Buller, who disliked his subordinate, would claim the credit if the assault was successful. Otherwise, Warren would be blamed. Preceded by an artillery barrage, a dawn attack by Warren on Thabaniyama Ridge, adjoining and west of Spion Kop, failed, and a stalemate ensued until Buller prodded Warren into further action. Warren reasoned the capture of Spion Kop would enable him to dominate Boer positions on the lower slopes, and a 700-strong task force commanded by General Woodgate. Just before 4 a.m. on 24th of January, he drove off a 70-strong enemy picket guarding the hill. Led by the 6 foot 3 inches 20-stone Lieutenant Colonel Thornycroft, 200 South African infantry spearheaded the attack supported by men from the Lancashire Brigade and the Royal Engineers. Woodgate's men dug a boomerang-shaped trench on top of the mist-shrouded hill, the stony ground making it hard work, but moving swiftly through the fog, the unseen Boers soon manned positions level with the British trenches. Not having accurate maps, the British generals were unaware that a spur called Aloe Knoll and some nearby hilltops were the same height as the summit, and when the fog rose, Boer riflemen poured a devastating fire from these locations. Others began shooting from the shelter of a girdle of rocks just below the summit, some being only about 30 yards from their enemy. Woodgate soon realised that instead of being in a commanding position, his troops were caught in a trap. About 9 a.m., Boer artillery from concealed positions began a deadly triangular fire on the troops crowded along the summit. The numerous casualties inflicted included a mortally wounded General Woodgate, and Colonel Crofton took over, sending a signal to Warren reporting his superior's death and requesting reinforcements. Using smokeless powder, the expert Boer gunners were never located by the 10 times numerically superior British artillery. Trained to fire in volleys when ordered, the British infantry were no match for the Boer riflemen with their ability to exploit natural terrain. Soon after midday, when the enemy rushed their trenches, some Lancashire Fusiliers raised the white flag, but the gigantic Thornycroft rushed up and yelled to the Boer officer, "I'm in command here. There is no surrender. Take your men to hell." The abashed Boers withdrew, but 300 British from another sector had already given in, and when the enemy escort ran after being fired on, their prisoners ran with them. Watching the battle from a distance through a telescope, Reedvers Buller observed the activities of Thornycroft and signalled Warren to put him in charge. This was done, Thornycroft being promoted from Lieutenant Colonel to Acting Brigadier General. During the afternoon, reinforcements ascended the hill, increasing Thornycroft's force to about 5,000. Not being told of the latter's promotion, two other senior officers, Major General Coke and Colonel Hill, thought they were in command. War correspondent 26-year-old Winston Churchill climbed the hill about 4 p.m. and, rushing back to Warren's headquarters, 2 miles away, harangued the general about the precarious state of the troops. Warren shouted, "Who is this man? Take him away and put him under arrest." After a staff officer explained, the general relented and sent Churchill back with a message for Thornycroft to hold on as mountain guns and more troops would arrive in the morning. On the way up, Churchill met retreating soldiers, and contacting Thornycroft about 11 p.m., learned he had ordered a withdrawal and was not interested in Warren's message. Had he sent scouts to reconnoitre the enemy positions, they would have found them deserted with the Boers in full retreat and an almost unhindered passage to Ladysmith. Despite the blunders and futility of the High Command, the British lower ranks had stubbornly resisted Boer efforts to regain the summit, convincing them they were beaten. However, the Boer withdrawal in wagons and on horseback was quickly halted by Borta, their commander, whose tongue-lashing persuaded them to reoccupy the lower slopes of Spion Kop. In addition to their artillerymen, about 800 Boers had taken part in the day-long fight, suffering 200 casualties. In the pre-dawn hours, two Boers, looking for a dead comrade, found the British had departed, abandoning their dead and wounded, and Borta's men climbed up and took over. Dust haze in the distance drew attention to the British columns in full retreat. Filled with dead and wounded, many dreadfully mutilated by shell fire, the British trenches were a horrible spectacle to the Boers, making them weep. They did their best with the wounded until British medical personnel arrived. Among the stretcher bearers was a detachment of 25 Indians led by Mahatma Gandhi, who subsequently became his country's prophet and leader in the struggle against the British yoke. Two others present who afterwards made history were Winston Churchill and the kindly Boer leader Louis Botha, who was appointed the first Prime Minister of the Union of South Africa in 1910. As Britain's ally in World War I, he suppressed a rebellion of dissident Boers and conquered Southwest Africa from the Germans. The British gave their losses as 322 killed, 583 wounded, and 300 prisoners of war, while the Boers acknowledged 58 dead and 140 wounded. However, like most official counts, the figures were deemed to be unreliable, and many more were believed to have died on both sides. The trench dug by the soldiers became the tomb of most of them. And today memorials are placed among the boulders and bushy mimosa trees with their fragrant yellow blossoms. The grass, which grows amidst the rocks, is green in summer, and following winter frosts, tinged with red, like the blood which stained the summit at the turn of the century.